Arthur is showing you the dangers of idolatry as he continues the study here on Grace to You titled Pitfalls of Christian Liberty. Now let's turn the corner for a moment. John, I know that when you're preparing to preach a sermon like the one we just heard, you spend more time interpreting the scripture, understanding what it means when it was written, than you do figuring out how the passage applies to Christians today. So talk about that decision. Why is it better to help folks interpret a passage than to apply it?
Well, obviously, you can't apply something until you've interpreted it. It does amaze me, however, how many preachers read a passage and then apply it without ever interpreting it. The power is in the interpretation because the interpretation unleashes the divine truth. The meaning of the scripture is the scripture. It is the revelation. You can have a Bible, but if you don't really know what God means by what he says, then you do not have the divine revelation. You can't apply it until you know precisely what scripture is saying. It's not enough to read a verse and make some sentimental comments about it, try to find a way to apply it. The power, and we've seen this through the years, the power is digging down into that verse to see the profound depths of its doctrinal, theological meaning. That is where the power lies. And then you unleash it on people as to its truthfulness alone, and the Spirit of God takes it and makes those applications. I would love to remind you that I've written commentary on the New Testament, 33 volumes on all 27 books, the MacArthur New Testament commentary. This is how you get to know the meaning of every verse in the New Testament. Every verse in the New Testament is covered in the commentaries, 33 volumes. Would love to get one in your hands. You could pick your favorite book and start that way and then begin to order them on a regular basis. Maybe you'd like to start with 1 Corinthians, learn about speaking in tongues, spiritual gifts, Christ's resurrection, the importance of love, 500 pages of clear exposition of just 1 Corinthians. Individual commentaries available, or you can get the whole set. Contact us today. Start thinking deeply about the Word of God.
The MacArthur New Testament Commentary is ideal for personal study, family devotions, or sermon prep. For anyone looking to study God's Word, order a copy as you contact us today. The volume on 1 Corinthians is available for $19, and shipping is free. Order it now, or any of the commentaries that you might need to complete your set, or if you like the entire 33-volume set, the MacArthur New Testament Commentaries, call 1-800-55-GRACE, or order online at gty.org. While you're online, gty.org, you'll also find thousands of other Bible study aids. So they're available free of charge. That includes blog articles from John and the staff addressing practical issues affecting you and your church. Also videos from conferences and more than 3,000 of John's sermons that are free to download in the MP3 or transcript format. All of that and more online at gty.org. And to keep up to date on the resources that are available through Grace to You, make sure you follow us on Twitter using the handle @GraceToYou and like our Facebook page. For John MacArthur and the entire staff, I'm your host, Carl Muller, thanking you for listening, encouraging you to watch Grace to You television Sundays on NRB-TV. Now that's DirecTV, channel 378, or watch online at gty.org. And then join us here tomorrow for another half hour of Unleashing God's Truth, one verse at a time, on Grace to You. Christian liberty has less to do with what you can or can't do, and more to do with, well, what at your core you desire most. John MacArthur explains that tomorrow on the next Grace to You.
out of the chapter, and I sent him a little sentence and said, here's a key verse from that chapter that kind of makes the whole rest of it make a little bit of sense, something we can practice in our life. And then I did it the next day because they texted me back. They made me feel like I was St. Augustine. They made me feel like Billy Graham. They were like, oh my God. There were like 7 mind blow emojis. And I'm like, oh, I'm gonna do that again. I feel affirmed by this. Sent it back the next night, another one. Oh my God, this is even better. This is incredible. This helps us so much. Thank you. And so the next night, I actually officialized it and I changed the name of the group thread text thing. And it took me an hour to figure out how to do that because I'm old. Old is the goal. That's my whole goal in life. I want to be old enough where I don't know how to work this text message machine like Moses. And so I changed the name and I called our text the Read the Bible in 4 Years Club because I did a little bit of the math. And if we only read a chapter a day, it'd be like 4 years to read the whole Bible that way. And I told Elijah, I'm like, we got to go faster, man. I got to get to Matthew. I cannot be stuck over here in Leviticus for this long. It's too long. He's like, no, Dad, I really want to see what the Bible's all about. That's why I started the club. I'm like, all right, you're the president. I'm just the secretary treasurer. You do the key verse this week. So he did the one the next night. And it was good. Not as good as mine. I've been doing this a long time. But he did pretty good. And then Kelsey did one pretty good. And then I was back to me, Kelsey, boom, boom, boom. So we're moving. We're moving through Exodus. We're moving through Leviticus. About halfway through Leviticus, Elijah goes, this is crazy. The Bible is so much better when you actually read it as a story instead of just selections that you take like a little shot, like a B12 shot to get you through the day. I got a B3 shot to get you through the week if you need it, if I preach good. That's what that organ is called, the B3. Show them how it sounds, LJ. Yeah, we could do it. We can do it in a minute. 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 Stop. So he said, it's so much better. And I've got so much invested in the Israelites now. I want to see what happens. And I'm like, uh-oh. This is not the winning team that you want to cheer for. Because I know they screw it up at every turn. At every turn. Even when they get in the promised land, they just got to be like the Canaanites. They just got to intermarry. They just got to go worship these other gods. So now they go and get to captivity 2 different times, even when Jesus came. So I'm like, uh-oh. This is a roller coaster, man. Hang in there. But we've been doing it. And guess what? This year, at the beginning of the year, we accepted our first new member on a trial basis to the book of Deuteronomy. Holly is now a part of the Read the Bible in 4 Years Club. And last Sunday, we finished Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 34 was the last one. And I read it. And I'm like, this is so sad, dude. Moses is up on a mountain. Isn't that a horrible thing that you can see something that God wants to give you, but you can't bring it into reality? I'd rather not even know that God promised it to me than to hear people talk about it and to see people walk in it. And man, their marriage seems happy and their kids are in church with them. And I can't get my kid to come to church. And there's old Pastor Steve up there talking about a Bible club with his boy. And that must be nice. You know, you can see things, but you only see scenes. You don't know stories. You don't know the story. There's so much more to the story. Elijah says, somebody told him the other day, Justin Bieber was at our house for the weekend. I said, would have been nice to know. I'd have made him sing on Sunday. I'd have put him up on Jira. Talk to Justin Bieber. I don't know Justin Bieber. Who makes this stuff up? Where does this stuff come from? Did God really say you must not eat of any tree in the garden? Matter of fact, he didn't. Serpent, devil. He said we can eat any tree, just not one. But you see how the spin gets you in a story. And there's so much more. to the story. I always listen to people these days kind of imagining what the other person might say if they were there to defend themselves. Because I know there's more to the story. Now in defense of Moses, come on, I did good. I led these rebellious, stiff-necked people for 40 years. You think you would have done better? You're only 40 days into the new year and you've broken every New Year's resolution that you've got and three from your neighbors. There's more to the story, you know, just to read it as, hey, Moses died because he struck the rock instead of speaking to it, and he couldn't go into the promised land because he didn't have faith. That is a summary, but it's not the story. That's a summary. That's not the story. Little side note, don't trust the summary. Parenting note, when your kid comes home and says, that teacher just told me to sit down and shut up and I didn't do anything. You believe that from your kid? You believe that? That's my baby. Yeah, that's your baby. And your baby is full of, your baby is got some BS blanket statements. Now, so to say that Moses still died with more in him is a little bit of a blanket statement because he did a lot. In fact, the writer of Deuteronomy, who some believe was Moses, said, and nobody ever did more for God than Moses. And it also says that he was the humblest man who ever lived. So if he wrote that, then that's very paradoxical, ironic, and funny to me. And so the Lord takes him up on a mountain, and he spent the whole book of Deuteronomy giving a speech. You know, make sure that when God brings you into the land, that you are the kind of person that can sustain the blessing that he wants to give you so that you don't receive the blessing and sabotage it because of selfishness, because of a lack of focus, and because of a lack of gratitude. And the Lord takes Moses up on a mountain. We've seen Moses go on mountains before, you know. And when he went up, he always came down with something important. God calls him up on a mountain. He's up there 40 days and comes down with the Ten Commandments to find the children of Israel dancing around a golden calf. And when he confronted them about it, the leader said, oh, yeah, I threw some stuff in the fire and the cow came out. I think there's probably more to the story. Do you know what I'm saying? Aaron, come on, man. I was born on day, but it wasn't yesterday. Come on, man. This is crazy.
But God is not in your life to bless your will. He wants to bring you into alignment with his will. And so it ends up in a debacle and a mess because it was never what God really intended to happen in the first place. We see the crushing place, and then we hear God talking about the oil. We see Samuel weeping, and then we see him holding up a horn full of oil. And God says to the weeping prophet, how long will you weep for who I rejected? I have found a man after my own heart. And he says, get up and fill your horn with oil and go. He brings him out of the weeping place. Throughout scriptures, you'll see the weeping place over and over again. Like when Jesus goes to the Garden of Gethsemane, it is the crushing place, it is the weeping place, it is the place in life that precedes the cross. Gethsemane literally means oil press. So I believe that that what happened to Jesus at Gethsemane is equally as important as what happened to him on Calvary. Let me show you. Because first of all, there wouldn't have been a Calvary if he didn't go through Gethsemane. Gethsemane was the place where he brought his will, Saul, in alignment with God's will, David. That place in your life where you go, and he tries to bring the disciples with him, and he tries to get the inner circle to go with him. But when you're in a certain state with God, you can't invite company. Everybody that likes you doesn't like where you're at, and they can't handle where you're at, and they can't deal with where you're at. And everybody that you like, you can't bring them because you like them. I have learned over the years that just because I like somebody doesn't mean that I can bring them into alignment with God's purpose and God's will for my life. They fall asleep. And you can always tell when you brought the wrong person because they fall asleep. They give out on you. They're not really with you. They don't really connect with you. Peter, James, and John have fallen asleep, and Jesus has gone on a little further. And we're going to talk a little bit about that tonight, because I want you to begin to get in your mind and in your heart and in your spirit that God loves you no less when you're crushed than he does when you're anointed. God doesn't love you any less because you're in a painful place. God doesn't love you any less because you're going through a place where your emotions are all in an upheaval and your life is in turmoil. That doesn't mean that God's favor has left you, that he loves you less, that he's not going to accomplish his purpose. Was Jesus any less God in Gethsemane than he was in the resurrection? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. He was out there praying until he bled out of his sweat glands. And yet, he was still God. And he wrestles in the will to bring his will into alignment. Because when your will is out of alignment and you've got two different voices and you're double-minded and you're halt between two opinions, there's more wear and tear on your life. You go to bed tired, you get up tired. You lay down tired, you rise up tired. You just slept 8 hours and you're still tired because you're wrestling all in your sleep because you don't have alignment. You don't have alignment, so you develop all kinds of disorders and excessive behavior and compulsive disorders and start medicating, self-medicating disalignment when what you really need is to come into a place where you say, not my will, but thine be done. When you start talking like that, demons tremble and hell gets nervous because the devil knows when you come into alignment, God is going to do something amazing in your life and the oil is going to flow. It's not going to leak, it's not going to drip, it's not going to drop, it's going to flow in your life. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? Look at the Gospel of St. Mark chapter 14 verse 32 for a minute. We're going to start there and we're going to take a look at verse 32 through 43. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. He almost sounds like Samuel did. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. He said to them, stay here and keep watch. Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that if it be possible, the hour might pass from him. Is there a way I can get out of this? Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. Now watch him come into alignment. Yet, not what I will, but what you will. Coming into alignment. Have you come into alignment yet? That you've given up on what you had in mind and you said, God, I reject what I had in mind and I'm open to what you want to do in my life, even if I have to move, if I have to change, even if I have to downsize, if it's less money, if it's less friends, if it's less glamour, if it's less this and less that. See, it's easy to align with God as long as God is asking you to do what you want to do anyway. It is much more difficult when God's will leads you into something that is against what you had in mind. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Come on, somebody. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Couldn't you watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, he says, but the flesh is what? Now the spirit is, and the flesh is, the spirit is, and the flesh is, the spirit is, and the flesh is willing and weak are in a fight here. Willing and weak are in a fight to see who's going to drive the narrative of what is going on in the Garden of Gethsemane, in the pressing place. In the pressing place, willing and weak are in a fight. Once more, he went away and prayed the same thing. Now, if Jesus had to pray three times, this once a week praying you've been doing is not going to work, sweetheart. Jesus had to pray three times to bring himself into alignment so that he was talking right and thinking right and saying the right things. Because when he first started praying, he was praying, but he was praying to have his way. And then he surrenders to the alignment of bringing his will into alignment with God's will, the Father's will, and what he had in mind for his life. Even though it didn't seem pleasant, even though it didn't seem good, even though it wasn't what he had in mind, even though there was a dark cloud over it, even though it was tempestuous, even though...
Damn Fruit of Looms on, old as your ass with the little trap door in the front. What
the
is the trap door for? Man, I can't fit in it. Let me tell you something one time. If I try to use that little trap door, boy, what? I might as well just stand there and pee on myself because there's no way.
Thank you, guys. Coming up at 20 minutes after the hour, it is Groundhog Day. Did Punxsutawney Phil see his shadow or not? We'll talk about it right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
When my daughter ran off to hop trains, I was terrified I'd never see her again. So I followed her into the train yard.
This is what it sounds like inside the boxcar.
And into the city of the rails. There I found a surprising world, so brutal and beautiful that it changed me. But the rails do that to everyone.
There is another world out there. And if you want to play with the devil, you're going to find them there in the rail yard.
I'm Danelle Morton. Come with me to find out what waits for us in the City of the Rails. Listen to City of the Rails on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts. Or cityoftherails.com.
Have you ever watched The Exorcist and wondered, are demons real? Well, we interviewed a leading exorcist to find out. And the truth was shocking.
Tell me who you are.
The one you won't get out. The one you can't.
Levitations, vomiting, spitting at the priest with an uncanny marksmanship. That has not been a movie for me.
Listen to The Exorcist Files on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.
In 1967, Joseph Stalin's only daughter flees Russia for her new home, America.
Hello to everybody. I am very happy to be here.
That story alone is worthy of a podcast, but Svetlana Svetlana is about what comes next, and it's the craziest story I've ever heard. It has KGB agents, a Frank Lloyd Wright commune, weird sex stuff, three Olgas, two Svetlanas, and one neurotic gay playwright. That's me. Listen to Svetlana Svetlana on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Nations of knowledge itself. Now, Kuhn observed that from time to time, there were discoveries that were made that shook the foundation of knowledge itself. There's some well-known revolutions in science. So the Newtonian revolution was a revolution in science. Einstein's work produced another revolution in science. Darwin's work, Mendel's work, those are the revolutionary transformations of thought that people often consider. Did I say Darwin? I certainly should have said Darwin because his was probably the most revolutionary of all. Now, the reason that I wanted to tell you that and the reason I kept it in here, even though it seems like a funny little additional statement pinned to the end of Piaget's quotation, is that Kuhn observed that science seemed to progress in accordance with the same mechanisms that Piaget observed that the knowledge of children appeared to progress. Now, one of the things that you'll learn about Piaget, which is generally all you learn if you learn about Piaget, is his idea that children go through sequential stages of development, and usually people have you memorize those stages. I should let you know that Piaget really didn't care that much about those stages and when they occurred and how they could be sped up and exactly what they were. He was much more interested in deep philosophical questions, and that element of his work generally goes unrecognized by the North American psychologists who purport to understand what he had to say. Now, because he wrote dozens of books, some of which are not yet translated, it's not surprising that people come away with a partial view of Piaget. When you're that prolific, he was so damn smart, he was offered the curatorship of a museum when he was 10, because he had published a scientific paper on, I think it was on snails, but his parents requested that he turn it down. So, you know, Piaget was a major genius, and if someone puts their mind, like that, puts their mind to work for an entire lifetime, and he lived to be an old man, they could produce an awful lot of intellectual material, and it's not necessary, especially if it can't be summarized easily as a single, you know, coherent theory that you could memorize in one page. It's pretty hard for people to keep up. So it's not surprising that his thought gets reduced to, you know, a set of axioms, in a sense, but the devil's often in the detail with great thinkers, and what that means is that to really understand what they had to say, you actually have to read them, because a lot of the information is at the sentence level of analysis and not at the summary level of analysis. You know, if you're really smart, it's not that easy to summarize what you have to say, because most of what you have to say is in fact informative, so you can't just throw it away. It's hard to compress it. So anyways, this initial paragraph opens up the world of constructivism to you. Now, the constructivists are interesting people because, you know, you often hear people ask, is it genetic or environmental? Which is, it's not a good question, because it's a false dichotomy. The genes formulate structures in accordance with environmental demand right from the beginning of the organism's emergence. And so there's a constant interplay between the environment and genetics. But the environment isn't also just a thing that's out there that's like made out of lions and tigers and moose and buildings and, you know, the sky. It's an information field. And the constructivists point out rightly that partly what you're doing when you're operating in the world is interacting with this field of information and incorporating its structure into the structure of your mind and body, which is how you adapt. So you could say in some sense that you're built out of information and matter. That's a good way of thinking about it. And the constructivists are very interested in how you go about acquiring information and how you then transform that information into the sort of knowledge that you can apply to the world. So they're also very pragmatic, especially Piaget, because Piaget regards knowledge as like the prerequisite for adaptive action. So again, he's less concerned about the facts that you know about the structure of the world than he is about how it is that you modify and adapt your behavior so that you can survive in the world. So that's the first postulate, that's constructivism. And then the next postulate is that there are revolutions in this internal structures that you construct that emerge as a consequence of you acquiring new information. Sometimes that information can already be fit into a knowledge structure that you possess, but sometimes the information is so anomalous or novel that it blows out fundamental presuppositions that you've already established and forces you to not only add some information to your repertoire of information, but to reconfigure the structure you use to represent the information. You don't like that. People don't like it when that happens. It's too dramatic and upsetting. So, which is often why revolutions in science or in any other field are first resisted. I mean, it's very complicated. The reasons people are opposed to new ideas are very complicated, and there's lots of theories about why that occurs precisely, but I'll briefly outline a good theory. There's a bunch of them, but I'll outline one. So let's say there's already a scientific theory and it's instantiated in the world, so people accept it. And let's say that you are a proponent of that theory. So you might say, well, that theory therefore governs your worldview, and if I threaten it, then your worldview is going to fall apart, and that's going to make you fall apart. And that's not a bad theory. But here's a variant of that which is similar, but which I think is better. So I'm a professor. Let's say I have a theory. Now, what I'm doing with my theory is buying my right to be a professor. So I would come to the University of Toronto as a job candidate, and I would say, here's my theory, and here's why I think the facts support it, here's what it's good for, and they'll say, okay, it looks like you know enough about what you're doing so that you can occupy this position in this dominance hierarchy. Okay, and I'm pretty happy about that, because that position in that dominance hierarchy is pretty permanent. That's one of the advantages to an academic job. It's like, once you have it, as long as you're relatively confident, and relatively ethical, then you can maintain it across time. So it's a big deal to be granted that slot. And then being in that dominance hierarchy is not only a matter of what you believe. Obviously, the fact that I'm in the dominance hierarchy means I get a certain salary, and that's not hypothetical. That allows me to eat, so I'm happy about that. It's not only psychological, and I can pay my housing payments with it and so on. So it protects me from the cold and offers me something to eat, and it gives me a certain public status. And so if some other joker comes along, say they're young, and they say, well, I have a different theory and it makes your theory look stupid, then I'm not going to be very happy about that, partly because it upsets the way that I configure my understanding of the world, and that's a drag, but I might recover from that. But it also undermines my claim. It undermines the validity of my claim to that position in the hierarchy. And so it sort of makes me an imposter. Say the guy turns out to be right. It's like, poof, I'm an imposter. And I no longer really have the right to occupy that position. And someone might even point that out, although it doesn't happen very often in the case of professors. You know, it happens fairly frequently in other sorts of occupations. You know, all of a sudden your position is made useless because somebody figured out how to automate you, and poof, you're gone. And like, that's hard on your worldview, but it's a lot harder on your salary. So a lot of the reasons that people cling to the validity of their theories is because it gives them a claim to a certain kind of, what we call skill set and utility, that then gives them a claim to occupy a certain position in the dominance hierarchy, and that protects them.
Hi, my name is Father Mike Schmitz, and you're listening to the Bible in a Year podcast, where we encounter God's voice and live life through the lens of Scripture. The Bible in a Year podcast is brought to you by Ascension. Using the Great Adventure Bible timeline, we'll read all the way from Genesis to Revelation, discovering how the story of salvation unfolds and how we fit into that story today. It's day 348. We're reading Acts of the Apostles, chapter 27, as well as the second half of St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapters 4, 5, and 6, as well as, in addition to, Proverbs chapter 29, verses 22 through 24. As always, the Bible translation that I'm reading from is the Revised Standard Version, Second Catholic Edition. I'm using the Great Adventure Bible from Ascension. If you want to download your own Bible in a Year reading plan, you can visit ascensionpress.com/Bible in a Year. And I'm warning you, unless you subscribe, I'm going to stop asking. I'll give you 2 more weeks, give or take, and then I'm done. Then I'm done asking. Maybe 3. I don't know. Maybe 3 weeks. That's it. And then I'll never ask again. If you want to subscribe, though, you can, and you're free to do that. You're also free not to do it, because you know what? You got this far without subscribing, and why give up that streak now, you know? I mean, here we are. It's day 348. We're reading Acts 27, Ephesians chapters 4, 5, and 6, and Proverbs chapter 29, verses 22 through 24. The Acts of the Apostles, chapter 27. Paul sails for Rome. And when it was decided that we should sail for Italy, they delivered Paul and some other prisoners to a centurion of the Augustan cohort named Julius. And embarking in a ship of Atramitrium, which was about to sail to the ports along the coast of Asia, we put to sea, accompanied by Aristarchus, a Macedonian from Thessalonica. The next day we put in at Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly and gave him leave to go to his friends and be cared for. And putting to sea from there, we sailed under the lee of Cyprus, because the winds were against us. And when we had sailed across the sea, which is off Cilicia and Pamphylia, we came to Myra in Lycia. There the centurion found a ship of Alexandria sailing for Italy and put us on board. We sailed slowly for a number of days, and arrived with difficulty off Cnidus. And as the wind did not allow us to go on, we sailed under the lee of Crete off Salmone. Coasting along it with difficulty, we came to a place called Fair Havens, near which was the city of Lycia. As much time had been lost, and the voyage was already dangerous because the fast had already gone by, Paul advised them, saying, "Sirs, I perceive that the voyage will be with injury and much loss, not only of cargo and the ship, but also of our lives." But the centurion paid more attention to the captain and to the owner of the ship than to what Paul said. And because the harbor was not suitable to winter in, the majority advised to put to sea from there on the chance that somehow they could reach Phoenix, a harbor of Crete, looking northeast and southeast, and winter there. The storm at sea. And when the south wind blew gently, supposing that they had obtained their purpose, they weighed anchor and sailed along Crete close inshore. But soon, a tempestuous wind, called the Northeaster, struck down from the land, and when the ship was caught and could not face the wind, we gave way to it and were driven. And running under the lee of a small island called Cauda, we managed with difficulty to secure the boat. After hoisting it up, they took measures to undergird the ship. Then, fearing that they should run on the Syrtis, they lowered the gear and so were driven. As we were violently storm-tossed, they began next day to throw the cargo overboard. And the third day, they cast out with their own hands the tackle of the ship. And when neither sun nor stars appeared for many a day, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope of our being saved was at last abandoned. As they had been long without food, Paul then came forward among them and said, Men, you should have listened to me, and should not have set sail from Crete and incurred this injury and loss. I now bid you take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For this very night there stood by me an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I worship, and he said, Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand before Caesar. And behold, God has granted you all those who sail with you. So take heart, men, for I have faith in God that it will be exactly as I have been told. But we shall have to run on some island. When the 14th night had come, as we were drifting across the Sea of Adria, about midnight the sailors suspected that they were nearing land. So they sounded and found 20 fathoms. A little farther on they sounded again and found 15 fathoms. And fearing that we might run on the rocks, they let out 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And as the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship and had lowered the boat into the sea under pretense of laying out anchors from the bow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, Unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. Then the soldiers cut away the ropes of the boat and let it go. As day was about to dawn, Paul urged them all to take some food, saying, Today is the 14th day that you have continued in suspense and without food, having taken nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take some food. It will give you strength, since not a hair is to perish from the head of any of you. And when he had said this, he took bread, and giving thanks to God in the presence of all, he broke it and began to eat. Then they all were encouraged and ate some food themselves. We were in all 276 persons in the ship. And when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship, throwing out the wheat into the sea. The shipwreck. Now when it was day, they did not recognize the land, but they noticed a bay with a beach, on which they planned, if possible, to bring the ship ashore. So they cast off the anchors and left them in the sea, at the same time loosening the ropes that tied the rudders. Then hoisting the foresail to the wind, they made for the beach. But, striking a shoal, they ran the vessel aground. The bow struck and remained immovable, and the stern was broken up by the surf. The soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners, lest any should swim away and escape. But the centurion, wishing to save Paul, kept them from carrying out their purpose. He ordered those who could swim to throw themselves overboard first and make for the land, and the rest on planks or on pieces of the ship. And so it was that all escaped to land. The letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians, chapter 4, Unity in the Body of Christ. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, beg you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all lowliness and meekness, with patience, forbearing one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is above all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is he who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And his gifts were that some should be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children, tossed back and forth and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the cunning of men, by their craftiness in deceitful wiles. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every joint with which it is supplied, when each part is working properly, makes bodily growth and upbuilds itself in love.
I was talking about the microbiome in the brain, and they're like, who are you? And now there's departments of metabolic psychiatry at Stanford and nutritional psychiatry at Harvard. And one of the top Harvard psychiatrists just wrote a book about how the microbiome affects the brain and mood. So I think we really have this moment of reckoning where we see this massive amount of depression and mental illness In fact, if you look at the healthcare costs over the next 35 years, the majority of the $95 trillion that we're going to have to deal with in terms of direct and indirect costs, the majority of that is not what you think. It's not diabetes or heart disease or cancer. It's mental illness. It's depression. And yet we know how simple it is to often treat these things by fixing these underlying biological causes. And then, of course, there's sometimes challenges with life and traumas and stresses that will cause depression that are real. But often people are suffering at the scale we have, not because they have a crappy life, but because they're what they're eating and they don't connect the dots. And so eating foods like fatty fish and which have omega-3s and berries with their anthocyanins and the fiber-rich and fermented foods to help your gut and nuts and seeds, which have tryptophan, help mood and energy. The Philanic green tea has great polyphenols and theanine that helps with anxiety. So there's a lot of benefits there just from eating foods that are going to help upregulate your brain and in turn your mood.
So if there are issues among teenagers and within prisons for getting access to healthy food and being able to eat in the way that is going to produce more positive physical and mental benefits, how do we deal with the problem of access? Do you think there's a problem with access in terms of, you know, distribution and the ability to get the highest quality ingredients? Or do you think it's also a problem of access in terms of education? Like people just don't know.
I think it's both. I think, you know, there legitimately are food swamps, which is where there's an abundance of foods that'll kill you, that are often go along with food deserts, which have lack of, you know, healthy foods that are hard for people to get. I mean, I had one woman crying to me in Cleveland who's was learning to be a chef at the community college, and we had a chance to chat, and she's like, listen, my mom wanted to feed us healthy. She had to take two buses. It took an hour each way just to go to the grocery store to get some vegetables because we had nothing in our neighborhood. All we could get were Little Debbie's or I think like Tostas cupcakes and whatever junk they could have. You know, it was horrific. So I think there is a real problem of inequitable distribution of food and access. But I also think it's a big problem of education. And you know, I think for me, that this really was highlighted by an experience I had in South Carolina. And I just have to admit that I did have a bit of prejudice before I really went down there in South Carolina and met this family. I thought, oh, well, people kind of know they shouldn't be drinking Coke and having all this junk food and going to McDonald's, and they do it anyway. And the truth is, they just don't know. And I went to this family's home. They lived in a trailer, a family of five on disability and food stamps. The father at 42 already had diabetes, had kidney failure, was on disability at 42 years old from diabetes, okay? And it wasn't type one, it was type two. And it was all diet related. And then the mother was, you know, well over 100 pounds overweight. The son was well over 100 pounds overweight. And they were struggling and they were trying to do the right thing because the father had to get a new kidney and he couldn't unless he lost the weight. And they were desperate to do the right thing. And it turns out that they just didn't know. I went into their kitchen, I did a biopsy of their fridge and their cupboard and their freezer, and I showed them what was in their food. They're like, oh, you know, look at this. It's a low fat, you know, low calorie dessert topping, Cool Whip. I'm like, yeah, it says zero trans fat on the label. I said, yeah, well, let's look at the ingredients because it's mostly air. They get away with legally lying. And the number one ingredient is trans fat and high fructose corn syrup. So it's poison. And yet they're selling it as a healthy dessert. And that's what they thought. So we just cooked a simple meal from real food. I gave them a guide on how to eat good food on a tight budget from the Environmental Working Group. And they lived in one of the worst food deserts in America, according to a rating standard, which is the Retail Environment Food Index, which is how many junk food and convenience stores there are to grocery stores. And they were like one of the worst. But somehow in this rural area in the middle of nowhere in South Carolina, they figured it out with the right education, a little bit of cooking skills, and they were able to lose 200 pounds as a family. The father lost 45, got a new kidney, and the mother lost well over 100, and the son lost 50, gained it all back because he went to work at Bojangles, but eventually got his act together and lost 138 pounds and went on to go to medical school. The first person to go to college, nonetheless, medical school in his family. So I think there's a real educational gap as well as an access gap. And both of those have to be addressed.
I'm glad you mentioned meat because meat is a big part of our diets today. How does it fit into the vegan diet? Is it possible to simply lower your meat consumption? And how does that fit in and how would you go about it?
Well, I think it's important that we lower our meat consumption to zero from any factory farm, whether it's pigs, chicken, meat, beef, it should be zero. And the reason for that is that it, one, is not great for you. The meat produced is obviously of lower quality and has hormones, antibiotics, and pesticides and all kinds of crap. Two, it's bad for the animals and the way they're raised. And three, it's bad for the environment and climate. So they should be banned. That's not to say that if we all, for example, were able to grow regenerative meat or raise pasture-raised chickens or have, you know, sustainable fish farms, that we couldn't be eating adequate amount of meat without having hugely limiting them. I mean, of course, we eat way more in America than we need to, obviously. But I think, you know, it's okay to eat, you know, a palm size full of animal protein once a day or twice a day. That's okay. And if it's done regeneratively, that actually is a net benefit, right? It's a net benefit to the planet. The UN says that if we took 2 out of the 5 million hectares of degraded land around the world and converted to regenerative agriculture, that we would be able to stop climate change for 20 years. And this is land that's degraded, that can't be used for anything else. And you start to put animals on them, you start to graze them, you start to do it in the right way. Because you can't just throw them on land and let them run around and whatever, they'll eat everything down into stubs, which is how we get deserts. It's a very specific type of grazing called adaptive multi-paddock grazing, and there's a lot of other terms for it. So I think it's really important to think about not how much, but you know what, right? The quality matters. So as I said before, it's not the cow, it's the how. And if we focus on that, sure, then we can find sources of meat, whether it's from Mariposa Ranch or Belcampo Farms, and we can buy stuff online that may be cheaper per serving for meat than a McDonald's hamburger. Because you could buy, for example, a cow share. You could buy a whole cow with a bunch of friends, chop it up and put it in a freezer, and then it's great. And I think people can learn how to shop in ways to get cheaper access to some of these things. So the more we do that, the more it'll drive the market, the more businesses will come online, the more the big companies will start to do this.
What you talk about in the Pegan Diet is that it's not just about creating and sustaining the health of a single person, but it's the health of an entire planet. So can you talk a little bit specifically about Principle 9 in your book, How to Eat Like a Regenitarian to Help Save Our Planet? Why should we care about soil specifically? And how do we accomplish the goal of ongoing soil quality?
I think increasingly people are very excited about eating in a way that's not only good for them, but good for the planet, and understanding the link between our food and food system and climate change. In fact, when you look at the data, it's pretty frightening. Depending on how you slice it, when you add everything together from deforestation to soil erosion to factory farming.
It says that he is the character, the stamp of his being. Now, if his being is omnipotent, eternal, unlimited, then the character must be as well, or it's not truly a character. It's not that stamp. And what we're being told is, well, it's not as clear, it's not as big, it's not as powerful, doesn't know as much, then it's not a character.
That's just not how copies are made.
Next question. Maybe a question for Dr. White.
Actually, the question is for both of you. Both of you have gone through very long explanations as far as the grammar for John 1:1. Could you try to simplify it as simple as possible so that everybody could understand the distinction between ha theos and theos in John 1:1c?
I went first on the last double one. Could we ask Mr. Stafford to?
Am I being asked to?
Yeah. We were both asked
White,
about
is
that.
Is Dr. White asking me to, or is...
No. The last time both of us were addressed, I had to go first, so you got to respond to me. I'd like to have the opportunity to go the other direction.
I just sense a reason behind this.
Yeah, I just explained what the reason was.
It's very simple. You have in John 1:1 a reference to two beings. One who was with God in the beginning. That one is described as theos without the article. God is described as theos with the article. You have a distinction made in terms of theos, one with the article, one without. The only fair thing it would seem to do is to carry over that distinction into our English translations. Few of them do it.
John 1:1 says the Word existed in the beginning. It was eternal. The Word was in personal relationship with the Father, and the Word is as to his being deity. This is paralleled with verse 18, which says he is the monogenes theos, who has revealed the Father. How can a mere God reveal the Father if he is indeed, and this takes us back to the issue we had before, the exact representation of his person?
We have time for one more question.
This question is for Mr. Stafford. Why would the Father allow the Logos to use so many names that he uses for himself, like Jehovah, Mighty God, Almighty God, Wonderful God, the First and the Last, etc., and yet expect people not to understand that Jesus is God in a non-Unitarian sense, i.e. in the context of those passages stating there is one God?
What you mentioned a lot of titles. I'm not familiar with a lot of names that are given to the Logos outside of the divine name itself, which I do believe is given to the Logos in some sense, just as is given to other spiritual beings in intertestamental Jewish literature, and even angels in the Hebrew scriptures who are directly addressed as Jehovah or God on occasion as they stand in place of God delivering his will and message to his people. I can think of no one who would be more befitting of the titles and descriptions that belong to God than his own son.
The question illustrates the point that we've been making all evening, and that is, if we believe that Jesus is a God, and all of these titles of deity can be applied to him, and we have to use that term in some sense, then we do not have any way of identifying what is idolatry. We have no way of identifying the true God and worshiping the true God in spirit and in truth. And that's been, I think, the primary issue this evening.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to commend both of you on the professional job you did and the decorum that was here. Thank you very much for coming.